So it's time to start, and I'm happy to greet everyone who joined us. I will be very quick, as both our presenters prepared a very interesting case study, and each of them will take up to 40 minutes sharing their vast experience with you guys. So the first one is Stijn. He's an expert with 15 years experience, and he was a marketing leader at Microsoft, and now he is a CEO at Mighty Co. I was very impressed with what Stijn shared with us during one of our previous calls about marketing, and that's why I requested that we prepare a joint webinar with Stijn. And I'm very happy that Stijn agreed, and he will be the first person. The second one is Mike. He's our in-house search engine optimization specialist, and we are working together on xcard.com. And I should say that I see the results daily, so he definitely has something interesting to share with you too. And after each of our presenters will finish our presentations, there will be a questions and answers session. So first of all, each of them is sharing their knowledge. And after that, you are welcome to post your questions directly into the chat window. As I can see, there are several posts and greetings from Robert and Charles and Nick and Douglas. Nice to see you guys. Please report any technical issues into the chat window too, just in case there is some problem with the sound, for example, and we will try to fix them quickly. You're welcome to post your questions once they appear into the chat window too, and we will handle them after the presentation is over. And I think it's time to start. So Stijn, please proceed.
Thank you, Ksenia. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you for that nice introduction, and thank you for having me on this webinar. It's an honor to be chosen to speak to some of your customers and prospects. It's really cool. As you mentioned in your introduction, I'm a marketer at heart, although I'm spending most of my time leading one of the companies that's related to xCard. We are a partner of xCard that does customer service solutions on the cloud platform, Mighty Call. But although I'm a CEO today, I really spend a lot of my time also at night and in the weekends thinking about marketing. And what I shared with the xCard team a few months ago was some significant results we had achieved at Mighty Call by doing some things a little different than what I had done the years before. And when Ksenia and Mike listened to that, they thought it might be interesting for some of you to take you through this. So I'm going to do that today. A little bit of my background. I was with Microsoft for a long part of my career. I managed product marketing for the Office team for a long time. I launched products like Office 2010, Office 365. And then in my last job, I ran the marketing team for the SMB market segment worldwide for Microsoft. And in all those roles, I was in the last 10, 15 years very involved in the transition to digital marketing and what that really means and how that for some people means managing things very numerically and with a lot of data analytics. And for other people, it means doing a pay-per-click marketing very well. And for others, it means doing things on a social media platform, etc. It means many things for many people. And I'll share some of my thoughts on that and how I, in the last year, really found a new way of doing some of these things, given the recent changes to how Google works, how some other marketing sort of dynamics have changed the last 2-3 years. Before I joined Mighty Call, I also ran sales and marketing for Acumatica, another SaaS ERP SaaS company. So all these things are software related, and I hope that experience is interesting for most of you. So why do I have the sort of the right to talk a little bit about this and sort of pretend that I know what I'm doing? I'm not sure, but we have some results that were very interesting. For me, they were very interesting the last couple of months especially. But even in September, October, November, if you look at the chart that I'm showing you, this is the marketing result early in the funnel from mitical.com. So this is a HubSpot, a screen, some of you may recognize it, that shows you unique visitors to a website and where they come from. And of course, this doesn't mean anything when these visitors don't convert to sign up for the product, etc. But it's a great indicator of how you're attracting new eyeballs, new potential customers to your website. The colors here are very important. Green is basically organic traffic. So these are people who type in something in a search engine and end up finding Mitical in this case, clicking on our link. And then you see some other smaller parts here. Blue is direct traffic, which means people typed in the URL of our company, mitical.com in this case, which is, I always think it's a proxy for brand awareness. It's a proxy for how many people really know about you, whether they know about you because they saw your URL and they, instead of clicking on it, they ended up typing it in, or they may have known you from another source and decided to type it in the browser. So for me, the blue is a great indicator of brand awareness, but I really want to focus on the green, because the green is really representing people who did not know about us before. They typed something in that was related to their need, their pain point, an opportunity they saw, something they were searching for, and they ended up finding mitical.com. Another interesting color here that is very small, and that's why it's interesting, is red. Red, dark red, is paid search. And what you cannot really see on this slide, but I'm going to just tell you that the last time Mitical did any paid search was in August. And you'll see a small sliver of red still in September. There was some traffic still coming in from some PPC that we had done in the end of August. But we basically turned off all our paid marketing, our pay-per-click marketing, during the summer of 2014. So this is basically the result that I shared with the XCAR team. And then the question, of course, was, okay, what happened here? What did you do and how did this work? So that's what we're going to talk about a little bit today. So if I do a double click on this traffic, and this is another tool that some of you may recognize, SEMrush, the tool that you can use to look at keyword rankings, how keywords either paid or organic are ranking when you type them in, where they end up in the Google search results. And what you can see here is that the mitical.com website used to rank for a very small number of keywords. When you look at the graph on the bottom of this picture, the bars that you see there, and you look at July, August, we were not ranking for a lot of keywords. I think it was 20 or 30 or something like that. And then you see in the fall, and especially in the winter time frame, that the amount of keywords that we were ranking for went up relatively fast. And a very important color to look at here is the lightest shade of blue in those bars here on the bottom. And I'm going to try to sort of highlight it here. Let me see if I can do that. Use one of these nice colors here. And my efficiency with the tool is not good enough yet. But when you look at the bottom, I'm really talking about those bars that you see above January to May 15, and the light color of blue becoming bigger. Those are basically keywords that rank in the top three search results in Google. And what's very important, and that especially the last 2 months, Google has started to crowd the search result page so much with new sort of promoted links, not paid links, but promoted links like Wikipedia and other sort of trusted sources, that the amount of organic search results that are really going to pop to the people who are searching is starting to become smaller and smaller. It used to be that the top 7 to 10 positions were all relatively healthy, but today, if you don't rank in the top 4, top 5, the chance that people are actually going to see your link and going to click on it is very small. So it's very important that this top three search result number is growing for your website. That's the only way to really get new people who did not know about your brand or your website before to find you organically and then, of course, click on you. So this was really what happened behind the traffic growth that you just saw. So what did we do? Let me go to the next sort of part of the presentation. a very important problem or challenge that most growing companies struggle with is how to balance doing things that have a quick return with things that have a longer lasting return. And we struggled with this at Microsoft, where we had quarterly revenue goals, and it was a really big company, just as much as we struggle with it in the startups that I run today. Mighty Call is a very small company, and the balance between doing things that have immediate impact and show shareholder value versus things that might only work a year from now, it's very hard. It's very difficult. It's very difficult to find resources to make long-term investment. So we had to really make a big bet and take some risk. If we wanted to do some things that might not have an immediate return, but we did know that they were the only things that could really show lasting growth. And I'm going to go deep into SEO and the topic of this webinar after this slide, but I wanted to just set the context. I think of marketing as having many levers. There are many things you can do to drive new interest into your brand awareness, new leads to your website. But I like to categorize things. It's a little bit black and white. And of course, it's not in reality, it's a little more nuanced. But I like to categorize the different things you can do to drive marketing in two categories. One are things that are relatively leading to relatively quick results, and they are also not as scalable over time. When you think of investing in your logo, in your branding, in the colors of your website, it's the logo you see on the left, that's a relatively easy project to define and quick to do. A lot of people invest time in redesigning their website, for example. Doing PPC, buying AdWords, buying clicks, relatively quick and easy to do. Buying a list is another example here. Doing social marketing on Twitter, trying to get some followers, trying to make some noise on Twitter. Doing a press release is another example. Doing outbound telemarketing, or throwing an event, a summit, or a party, if you will, to get brand awareness. All these things are on this upper left curve of things that help you get quick results, get brand awareness quickly, but they're also harder to scale. Although they're valuable, they're important, but they're not going to give you lasting growth, and they will never give you real exponential growth unless you get lucky and, for example, your event or a certain part of your branding campaign goes viral in itself and has some sort of specific exponential effects. But that's more luck than that you can really plan for that. The other type of marketing levers are on the bottom right curve. These are things that are typically a little harder to do quick, and they also don't show a lot of very quick results, which makes it also sometimes difficult to prioritize them, to set resources aside for them. And the most important one that we're going to talk a lot about today is doing SEO very well, search engine optimization. Because SEO really starts with understanding your customers really well, listening to them, create great content, etc. And you cannot do that quick and dirty. You see a lot of other examples here. Building a blog that people will actually follow, that is not something that's more of a renamed press release, but a real blog that is interesting for people, takes time to build. Doing social marketing on longer tail social networks like Quora is harder than on Twitter, because you really have to build a reputation. You have to grow engagement with certain parts of the community. The same with LinkedIn. And you see some other examples here. Focus on educational content, spring courses, winter courses, instead of throwing an event. Doing customer service really well instead of doing outbound tele. Focusing on landing pages instead of focusing on your homepage. All these things are harder to do because they don't give you instant gratification. They don't give you more traffic the next day or the next week even. Some of these things take months to yield results. But once they are going, of course, are much easier to scale. They can sometimes scale on their own without a lot of additional investments. So that's what we actually are going to talk about today. A lot of the things we did at Mighty Call, especially in the summer of 2014, were focused on this bottom right curve. And we consciously stopped doing a lot of things in the upper left. And it was not easy to do that. It meant that our shareholders and our our owners had to show and accept some pitch. Some of the results were maybe not going to come so quickly. And that's, of course, very visible if you look at our actual results that you see here. A lot of the work, actually, to achieve this growth was done in July, August 2014. We created a lot of content then. We did a lot of content amplification. We did a lot of influencer outreach in August, September, October, in the fall, where we got a lot of traction with our content being shared amongst influential communities. And a lot of that was not showing immediate results. Although if you would zoom into these results, the green is actually doubling between July, August, September, and October as well. So we still had very fast growth there, although it was not as extreme as you can see in January, February, March. A lot of this work was done in that early period. And I can actually admit to you that our marketing team has gotten much smaller over time. We had about 8 people in the summer of 2014, about 3 people in the fall of 2014. And right now I only have 1 person focused on marketing because we have some organic growth that almost grows automatically right now. But we are actually, we're able right now to scale back on our marketing investments a little bit and do even more longer term things. So that's really how that traffic got sort of generated, by focusing on what you see here on the lower right corner. And I tried to come up with a good name for that. I don't know yet what it is. It's a little bit what you could call organic marketing. Organic meaning you try to do things that are scalable, that are sustainable, without paying for them upfront. No sponsored content, no pay-per-click marketing, etc. So you try to play by some new rules. The most important of those rules is that relevance is king. When you build content, when you try to create a strategy to reach your audiences, what sort of events do you do, how do you reach them, that you really want relevance to be your guiding principle. And that's not easy. It's easier said than done. Everybody knows that marketing needs to be relevant. But when you really are honest with yourself and look at how relevant your messages are, how relevant your value prop is for your audience, how relevant your the conversations you have with as part of your sales process, or even your customer service team, then if you really are honest, sometimes relevance is not the first priority of marketing teams. And then reputation is sort of the next one. If you do things, do them well, do them consistently, be predictable, make sure that you are following up, following through, picking up the phone is a term I like to use, not literally, but there's so many organizations who generate organic interest when people actually come to their website, they find them, and then they don't do a good job servicing them with relevant content, relevant call to action, etc. And we'll come back to that in the next slide a little bit. But this is sort of the term that I'm coining to talk about what you do that's more focused on the bottom right of this model. So let me go into that that last comment on where do you service your customers? How do you pick up the phone of these people who actually end up finding you? Because it's extremely important to realize that how Google works these days does not just measure how many people link to your website, things like the traditional page ranking algorithm, but they're very focused on how people, after they find you, how they engage with you. Things like bounce rate and time on page are extremely important these days. And so when you realize that, and you start doing organic marketing and people find you and they click on a link, it becomes very important that the link they click on is relevant. And that when they land on your landing page, which should probably not be your homepage, that it's relevant for them, relevant for what they were searching for. And an interesting question to ask yourself or to ask your marketing team is how many people, what percentage of new visitors to your website lands on your homepage versus landing on dedicated landing pages. But because if in this day and age, a large percentage of the new people coming to your website lands on your homepage, you might have some challenges. You might have a challenge by servicing them in the right way based on what they were searching for, servicing them with with good content, with the right follow-up, with the right call to action. So this is a very important question to ask yourself. Because when I think of optimizing a website, I really like to think about two types of audiences that you optimize a website for. People who are your current customers, or people who you would like to become your current customers in the future. Those, I think, are the most important audiences for almost every website, and especially the XCard community, who are mostly building e-commerce environments. If you think of it like that, then some of the website design that you see, some of the way websites are optimized, is not really good. A lot of websites are optimized for other audiences, for stakeholders, shareholders, employees, press, influencers, etc. And they're not really focused on these two audiences, people who are either your current customers and need to be helped somehow with a question they have, a need they have, etc., a return purchase they want to make, or this other big audience, people who are not your customers yet, but you want them to become your customers. And that is that large group of people who I think should never land on your homepage. They should land on a landing page that is optimized based on what they were looking for. And this gets us to another sort of point. All of you probably, if you have done some search engine optimization in the last 2-3 years, you are all aware of the phenomena of Google not disclosing anymore what people are searching for in the organic analytics data that Google provides. You can call it the unclassified search result problem. And it's basically driven, Google says it's driven by people having SSL sessions, secure sessions, and that's why Google doesn't think it's appropriate to share what they were searching for when they performed the search. And it leads to about 70-80% of traffic typically being unclassified. The reality is that Google probably also does it like that because they like to sell more AdWords. But that aside, it's something we as marketers have to deal with, and it makes it even more important that a large percentage of your new visitors to your website lands on a dedicated landing page, because that's the only way you can sort of guess what they were searching for. Because you know what that landing page is ranking for, you know how that landing page is ranking for certain keywords that will help you estimate what you think the people who will land on that landing page were looking for. And that way you can give them great content. And that's really important, because the modern buyer's journey, the way people buy these days, really involves entering a search query about 93% of the time. 93% of people, this was some research by IDC in 2014, have done a significant amount of research online before they actually come to interact with you, before you get in touch with them, before they come to your website, before they give you their email address. So if you realize that 93% of people already have typed something into a search engine, then it becomes very important that they will find you, and that when they find you, you service them with relevant content and with the right value prop, the right call to action, etc. And there's no better way to do that than on a dedicated landing page. And this is something I want to really point this out. That's not just true for B2B. Some marketers really think that this new buyer's journey, where there are many people involved in the buying decision, someone playing a legal role, someone being a procurement officer, someone being the business decision maker, etc., that it's only applicable to business-to-business selling. But it's really not. It's actually applicable to a lot of business-to-consumer sales processes as well. If not every one of them, whether it's buying a car or some other B2C, longer sales cycles, this modern buyer's journey, which involves a lot of content research, is applicable to B2C as well. I'd like to point out an example that I came across actually just last week. SoundView Medical Supplies is a company that sells medical supplies to elderly care homes. So these are homes with a few residents that need specific medical supplies to service their customers. And it's a complete B2C scenario. These customers are their residents themselves or their children. But the buying process is relatively complex. When a child buys something for their parents, they're typically brothers and sisters involved. The parents themselves have an opinion, etc. And all this starts with a lot of online research. It starts with education. It starts with children trying to understand what the needs of their parents are, etc. So I'd like to challenge every marketer to really think of this new buyer's journey as an educational process that involves multiple actors. It involves multiple people who will somehow influence the, in the end, the buyer's decision. So that's an important thing to realize. If you then do another test, test how many, if you do a query on how your website is ranking for certain keywords, how many of those are non-branded? And I'm going to try to share my screen here to give an example of that. Let's see how I do that. Yeah, I'm not sure if I can. So what I really wanted to say is when you do a query, for example, in a tool like SEMrush, and you look at what your website is ranking for, most websites are ranking for branded keywords first. A lot of the brand names of the products they carry, the company name, etc. And that's of course great, but it's very important to realize that those are people who already know about you. They already know about your product, they already know about your company. And it's really key to focus on non-branded keywords, things that will lead people who don't know about you yet to your website. So that's a very important part. And then let me wrap up this slide by coming back to that concept of landing page. So if you buy into the concept of having as much of your visitors, or especially your new visitors, land on dedicated landing pages, then you have to realize that landing pages have two functions. And many people are very focused on the latter function, conversion. How do you make sure that when someone lands on your landing page, that you convert them quickly to the next action, to the next step, a call to action, whether it's signing up for a webinar or joining an email list or actually trying or buying a product. And that's, of course, very important. The landing page needs to be focused on conversion. But what is often forgotten is that it has the second function of being one of your primary SEO pieces of real estate. Again, there's a lot of focus when people do SEO on the homepage, but the landing page is maybe even more important because you want that landing page to rank for those non-branded keywords that will drive the specific audience to that page that you'd like to convert with the relevant call to action. So all these things might be very well-known or obvious to some of you on the call, but it's mind-blowing how many people still have issues doing this or have not done this correctly. Let me go to the next slide. Content. So when you buy into this concept of organic marketing and driving non-branded keywords and driving educational content, a lot of marketers end up asking themselves, okay, how do I do a good job building great content and do it economically in a viable economical way, do it relatively cheap and do it relatively quick? And what's interesting is that a lot of people over-engineer their content calendar, their content strategy. I think the best content is actually very easy to find. If you think of your current customers and interviewing them, or what they like about your product, or like about your company, and writing stories about them, not necessarily complete case studies or testimonials, just stories about how customers use your technology or your product, and quotes that you can get from your customers, or that you can create yourself and get customers to sign off on, it's relatively easy to do, and it's fantastic content. Then you start with your salespeople. You ask your salespeople, what do you talk about with customers? What do customers ask for? Organic marketing starts with creating great customer personas that educate you on what your customers need, where they find you, what they're searching for, what their pain points are, etc. The easiest way to create great customer personas is to interview your own sales team and understand what they talk about with customers. What do customers ask for? What do they need? What are they considering when they consider you versus the competition? How did they find you? It's very easy to ask those questions to your customers or your prospects when your sales team first talks with them. And then once you've done that with the sales team, an even better source maybe for great content is your support team, your customer service team. they are not talking with customers about what their needs are, what they think their needs are. They're talking about with their customers about what their needs really are every day, because they're already using your product. And they might be complaining about certain things. They might be expressing things that work well or that don't work so well. And then you can ask your support team to ask the why question. Ask your customer, why are they using a certain feature, the product, why do they buy a certain thing from you? Why do they really need it? What is it doing for them? What pain point are they trying to solve? Why is it so important to do it with your product? And before you know it, you get fantastic content opportunities. Influencer marketing. So when you think of a certain topic, you're in a certain business, you're selling a certain product, you're selling a certain service, there are a lot of tools that can help you understand how people are talking about your type of product, your type of topic online. I listed two examples here, Bazumu, Little Bird Influencer Marketing, and another one where you can type in certain keywords, you can type in certain influencers, and you can find relatively quickly how people are discussing those topics, what people care about, how people are sharing it, who is sharing it. So that's a great way also to find new content opportunities, to understand what people seem to care about because they share it. And you can sort of think about how do you maybe write things or publish things that are along the same lines that could add to that conversation. Another tip that is I think very underutilized, everybody runs around today with smartphones with great recording capability. Just record conversations that you have with your salespeople, your support team, your customers. Record conversations yourself about topics that you think customers might care about. And throwing those recordings to people who can write them up as a blog or as a quick article is relatively easy. And it's a relatively low friction way to get to some really good content quickly. And then finally, once you've made a list of things that you think your audience, your customer personas might care about, then it's a good time to map it to the buyer's journey. The journey that people go through when they first are looking for something to fulfill their need, to solve their problem. It's often called the awareness part of the buyer's journey, where they're not aware yet maybe of you and they need to be able to find you based on what they're typing into Google, etc. Then the next step in that phase is the consideration phase, where a potential customer thinks about their different options, right? And how are they considering you as one of the solutions to solve their problem, solve for their need. And then finally the decision where they are weighing their options and making a final decision based on things they care about. Could be price and there could be other attributes, of course. So you map your content to that buyer's journey. But it's hard to start that way. It's better to start with what are the things people care about? Listen to those conversations. And once you have a list of 10, 15 things, then you can think about, okay, how does it map to people educating themselves? And is the way we talk about this topic better done in a blog where people can find us organically, when that would be applicable to the awareness part of the buyer's journey? Or should I write a white paper that I publish and that maybe that I only make available to people if they give me their email address, which is more part of the consideration or the decision part of the buyer's journey? So that's really just a few notes on content and how do you create great content. Once you've done that, it becomes extremely important not to hide your content. It is amazing how many websites have not done a good job with what's called on-page SEO. Just having the basic SEO in good shape that you control yourself, your own website, the quality of links, the quality of the metadata on the pages, the titles, the URLs, make them all clear and clean. Make them interesting for your audiences. Make sure they work. I'm actually with a skewed eye, I'm looking at the chat where some of you tell me that we have at the Mythical website, we actually have some 404 link errors. I've never seen that in the last few months. It's really interesting that it happens today because my team has actually been extremely focused on on-page SEO and fix 404 errors, fix duplicate content errors, fix 500x errors, because that's really important. If you have fantastic content and you write a great blog, it's such a crime against your marketing team if that doesn't get crawled by Google because there's duplication. or it doesn't get crawled by Google because there are just the metadata is not insightful enough and it doesn't get accredited to a certain keyword. So a lot of these things are really basic, but they're extremely important. There are many tools to do on-page SEO audits. You can do it with SEMrush, with HubSpot, with Moz, many other tools. Google, of course, Google Webmaster Tools. But make sure that's one of the first things you do when you already have content, because it has to get credited by Google. It also is interesting to look at when you're trying to optimize for certain keywords that you want to rank for, to look at what the top 10 results look like in Google. So there are a lot of tools you can use to do keyword optimization and SEO optimization for certain keywords. But the easiest is not used a lot by many people. It's basically typing in those keywords in Google and see what are the top 10 results and study those results. Study those results and look at what people are writing about, what are the sort of SEO characteristics of those results, what are the titles, the headlines, the URLs, etc. What do they talk about? What do they point out? And without copying any of that, interesting what you can learn from the top 10 results of something that you would like to rank for as well. And then finally, be very careful with gated content. So not having great on-page SEO is an unconscious way of hiding your content. But then there are also a lot of marketers who are hiding content because they want to, and it's called gated content, because you want to use the content to get to know someone, for someone to give you their email address, their phone number, etc. And that absolutely has a great purpose. And somewhere in the conversion funnel, you need gated content to help people make the next step, and give you the next piece of information, etc. But you always have to wonder, if that's what you need to do, if you need to force people to give you their information, is your value prop good enough? Is your messaging good enough? Are they actually willing to give you their information without you having to gate your content? And it's a little bit related to not paying for clicks. Paying for clicks is almost an easy way out for marketing. It means you maybe have not to do as great a job on your messaging, on your value proposition, on your branding. And then you get away with that because you pay for clicks. Gating content is a little bit like that. If you're not doing a good job with your messaging, with your value prop, with your content, maybe that's the reason people don't give you their email address. They don't tell you, hey, it's okay to follow me home. Here's my information. Because if your marketing is great, you might not need gated content to do that. And I'm not 100% against gated content, to be clear, but I'm just challenging everybody to not use either pay-per-click marketing or gated content as an alternative for great messaging, great website design, and great content to begin with. So that we're almost sort of at the end of this a quick sort of overview of what we did at MightyCall. What's very critical is once you have content, once people can find the content, is that they're actually aware of the content. And this is something, this is related to, of course, how aware your audience is of your brand, of your product to begin with. And I like to think about it as marketing a new book. If you're an unknown writer and you've never published a book before, but you wrote a great book, you're not doing anything, you're not copying any content, you're really writing about a new topic that's very interesting for a lot of people, you might never find success if nobody knows about you. So you need to make sure that if you write some great content, that the content gets seen by some people. And let's sort of follow the book analogy a little bit to talk about how Google works these days. There are two key moments in how the search algorithm of Google works these days. And it happens really early after your content gets published and a few months after your content gets published. And I'm going to take the book analogy a little further. If you walk into a bookstore, there are typically two tables of books that you run into right away. One is the table with new books, new releases, basically. And the other is the table with bestsellers. These are sort of the books that really get promoted by the bookstore for you to see when you walk in early. And Google does something similar. What Google does, they basically, when you launch new content, your content gets crawled for the first time, they give it an extra look. Google basically gives you about 24 to 48 hours. Nobody knows exactly, of course, these things are kept pretty close by Google. But it seems to be when we do a lot of testing and other sort of SEO agencies do similar tests, that the Google algorithm gives you a little bit of an extra bump in search rankings in the first few days after your content gets crawled. And what Google is really doing is they're putting your content on that new book table, new releases. They're asking the world to test if that new content that you just created is any good, is any new good value. And Google will look very closely on when people click on your content, when they go to your landing page, whether they will bounce, whether people will stay on the page or they bounce away. And Google will give that a lot of weight, how your content is doing early on, those first few days after you publish it. And then the next very critical moment is about 2-3 months later. So the other thing that Google cares about is if your content actually has lasting value, if it has a long shelf life. If after a few months people come to your content and they click on it, are they still staying on your website? Are they staying on the page? Are they not bouncing immediately? Because that tells Google that the content has lasting value. It was not just a piece of news. So that's really important, those two key moments. And so when you publish new content and you're aware of those moments, you can do a few things. The most important part is that you share your content before you publish it with people who can help you create great content, make it as good as possible, but also potentially share it. So when you write a blog, a lot of people, when they write the blog and they're finished, they cannot wait to just publish it and be done with it. And what we really do at Mitico, we make sure we wait a few days by just engaging influencers with the content before we publish it to get their feedback, to make sure they're aware of a blog that we're thinking of publishing. And maybe they like it, they don't. But when we share that with them and we involve them and we acknowledge their expertise, they're very likely to help us share it later and to help actually promote it. And of course, they will give us feedback and it will make the content better. So that's really important. You use influencer and that feedback loop to create content and help them share it early on. This is the only area as well where I think PPC, pay-per-click, and spending a little bit of money is maybe a good use of marketing money, because it will have a lasting effect. If you use PPC to pay for normal clicks in AdWords, although it can create good solid leads with a good customer acquisition cost, it's not scalable. If you want more leads, you have to pay more. But when you do PPC, for example, on Twitter or some other social networks to target specific audiences with your content, and the goal is not so much to get visitors to turn into customers, to get leads, but the goal is really to promote your content, then we have seen some really good effects there, especially when you do it early in the content lifecycle. Use some ads to promote the content. The most sophisticated way to do that is with things like content syndication tools, where your content can be shown with PPC, with a PPC model next to other content that's similar, where people see are already reading some content that's like what you're talking about. And we've seen that to work as well. So PPC used for content amplification, I believe, is a good use of PPC dollars, because it's relatively cheap and it can have lasting effects if it helps your content to start ranking and to start being seen by others. So finally, I want to talk about social media marketing. Social media marketing is a very tricky and interesting subject. For some companies, it means making more noise and using tools like Twitter and Facebook to reach large audiences. Use things like, I will follow you and I hope you will follow me to grow an audience, and then just use it to make more noise. I don't think that has a lot of lasting value. It can help sometimes with short-term pushes of a certain message or a certain launch. But long-term value from social media marketing might be easier found in what I would call long-tail social networks. And I provided a few examples, and these are different based on the community you serve or the audience you have. But Quora is an example, Reddit, Discuss, Spiceworks in the technology industry. Another one here, Business Advice Forum, in the community that is probably attending this webinar. And so there are a lot of these forums or message boards that have the same a concept as the larger social networks like Twitter and Facebook. There's a reputation involved, followers, engagement scores, etc. But they are far more precise and far more targeted when it comes to the topics that are being discussed. And once you get people to care about you, your presence, the way you engage in a community, the way you answer questions, etc. In these communities, in certain groups in these communities, LinkedIn is another example, then it becomes easier to promote your content in a natural way with people who really care about the topics you write about and who might be great advocates to share your content. So doing social media marketing, in my recent experience with Mitical, works much better with these social, with these long tail social networks than with things like Twitter and Facebook. So finally, I'm going to share with you, so this is sort of the formula that we used at Mitical. What I did in the last few months is try to wrap a lot of the things we do up in a Trello board with action items, all the things we did to drive the organic marketing success at Mitical. And I have this, and I'm happy to share this with people. It basically gives you a sort of a recipe of all the very tactical things we did to build the organic marketing success that we had. That's basically that's it. Let me wrap up and hand it over to Mike or Xenia to take us to the next topic.
Just a second, I was unmuting myself. I think that we need a very quick break. First of all, I was thinking that Mike should follow Stijn after that, but I'm realizing now that we do need to interact with our audience now, because your presentation was very interesting but quite long. And I have just collected several pieces of software which was mentioned during your presentation in the chat window. These are aggregators, I guess, which helps to collect search engine optimization information about your website. They were suggested by our attendees. And I know that you, Stijn, are very and very acquainted with lots of tools. We have advanced knowledge about many of them. So if you could comment on each of them, let's take a look into the chat window. It's SEMrush, Spyfy, I guess, WebSEO, and HotSuite, but I might be wrong pronouncing the names. Anyway, if you can comment on each of them, please do that. And while our participants, please post your questions now.
Okay, yeah, I'd love to do that, Xenia. And to be honest, I don't know all of them. There are about 450 marketing tools these days. It's another effect of a long tail trend. Like just for keyword research, I think there are at least 12 tools that I've seen, from keyword Twilio to larger platforms like Moz and SEMrush. And so I'm not going to pretend I know all of the tools, but I'll share you with you the thoughts that I have on the ones that are listed here, the ones that I know. So SEMrush for me is interesting because they have one of the largest databases that tracks historical keyword performance. And it's definitely not complete for everybody, because the amount of keyword combinations that people are interested in is limitless, of course. It's impossible for any company to track all of those. But SEMrush has a relatively big database that gives you much more historical keyword information, how keywords ranked in the last few months, for example, than anybody else. So that's interesting about SEMrush. And then, of course, when you have a paid subscription, they allow you to upload and they will start tracking the ranking for those. And they do it independently from Google, so they do their own queries every day to get sort of the ranking of all those keywords. That's what makes SEMrush, I think, specifically interesting. And in addition to that, it also does a decent job with SEO audits, so you can sort of find how your website is optimized for SEO today for an all-up website crawl. Not so much like smaller tools like Yoast to do it when you're publishing content, but SEMrush does a good job just doing an all-up site review. The same is true for Moz, M-O-Z. Moz is, I think, the biggest competitor for SEMrush that is a little more of an end-to-end platform, focused 100% on inbound and organic marketing, but it includes more than just keyword management. It also includes things like social presence and mentions and how you turn that into links to your website, etc. I don't really have any experience with SpyFu and with Web SEO, so I'm happy to learn about those more. Hootsuite for me is more of a tool that helps you make noise. That doesn't mean it's bad, but it's really more positioned on that upper left curve when I sort of drew all my my opinion on the different types of marketing levers. I would put Hootsuite on the upper left, which helps you more effectively and very efficiently have a presence on many social network sort of outlets, and Twitter most importantly, of course. But I'm not sure if it helps you listen better. So I don't use Hootsuite a lot. I like tools like Bazumu and Little Birds more for a social media approach, because it's more about listening instead of making more social noise. But that being said, I don't use Hootsuite a lot, so I don't know maybe everything about it. Now, what other tools were mentioned earlier in the chat, Ginny? I'm scrolling up. Let me see. A lot of tools we use. I don't see any others in the chat, but I can talk about some of the others we use. I use a tool called the Rival IQ, which is a really interesting small tool that gets you a lot of insights across, let's say, 10 competitors. What all their web pages look, you can compare all the home pages for all your competitors, all the customer pages, the partner pages, and see what the URLs are like, the titles, the meta descriptions. It's a very quick way to compare all the SEO attributes of all your competition's website. It's called Rival IQ, and we can share a lot of these later as well. Xenia, I'll type this into the chat window as well. Another tool we use is keywordtool.io. It's an interesting quick and dirty tool to give you a lot of long tail keyword combinations after you've set on your initial keyword priorities. Google Analytics, of course, is extremely powerful, and having your team being well trained on Google Analytics and webmaster tools is a very important starting point. It's amazing to see how many marketers actually don't use Google Analytics or webmaster tools to its fullest extent. So that's another tool that I always recommend. Let me stop there, Xenia. I'm not sure how much time we have. And then,
Yes, I'm stepping in. Thank you so much for answering these questions. There are also several technical questions in our chat window, and I think that it's better now that Mike joins our presentation, because his presentation is going to be a little bit more technical. It will also cover W3C validation and Google Analytics and Webmaster Tools, etc. So, Mike, I'm muting myself. Please proceed.
Hello there. Here we go. So, what are we discussing today? It's mainly the journey of XCard.com from 2012 to 2015. In 2012, we had fourth position in USA in terms of shopping cart and Google. Shopping cart is, let's say, the most lucrative, most interesting key phrase for our industry, on the software industry, in terms of traffic. It's not so good in conversion. It gets so much traffic that it converts more than its next follower. In 2015, we managed to get first position on it, and also first position on the commerce software, which is the second best term in our industry, and which offers much better conversion. Well, the top management didn't let me give you actual numbers. All I can tell is the traffic rose about 120% in that time. The first thing I'd like to highlight is when you wish to climb high in highly competitive terms, like it was the case for us at XCard, You cannot copy others. Copying others does not work. When you're copying someone, Stijn, please mute your microphone. It's getting echo. Okay, so when you're copying others, Google sees that you're copying, and it gives you less credit for it. It doesn't mean copying the text, it means copying the approach. For example, when your competition starts to move to longer search terms and start to create multiple articles with lesser quality, less content quality at, say, reaching keywords, and you start to copy this to be telling plus one of us, one of our competitors try this once. And Google will always give less credit to the one who doing the second. So if you aim at the top, you have to be original. You have to be ahead of your competition and force them to copy. Okay, when you start, the first thing you got to do is set up your basic tools. Stijn told me, had mentioned a number of aggregators such as SEMrush. They are good tools, they are good for most cases, yet they have their limitations. For example, they are keeping all the data locally, so the data on most recent changes they have, it's not always up to date and not always complete. So call me conservative, yet I prefer to take things directly from Google, this kind of things. Yet for some projects, and it would be majority of projects, things like SEMrush really work really good. Thing you really need is to set up early is Google Webmaster Tools. Google Webmaster Tools is the place Google will send you. Google will send you any warnings about your content, about your website, if anything goes wrong, so you can spot them early and react early, and thus avoid any unpleasant consequences about it. The thing you need to keep in mind about Webmaster Tools is that they are tracking HTTP and HTTPS as separate websites. So if you, like Google did some time ago, would move your entire website into HTTPS, you need to keep that in mind and set up a second Webmaster Tools account beforehand. Another tool which is a must-have is Google Analytics. It has several peculiarities too that can make it more harm than use. So things you need to keep in mind, for example, when your sales process goes through several domains or subdomains, like with us in Xcard, when we have one subdomain.
Mike, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but the sound seems to be breaking sometimes, so please repeat the last paragraph.
Which one?
The one you were just speaking about right now.
Okay. So let's talk about the Webmaster Tools again. Okay. The aggregators. It's services like SEMrush. Which Stijn before me had mentioned. They are good tools, they have some really good info, however, they have the limitations, or they are keeping their data locally. So their data is not always up to date and not always complete compared to Google. Google has more resources, and it's actually Google they are taking the data from. Therefore, I prefer to take data directly from Google, but that's my preference for most projects. aggregators like SEMrush will be much good. Webmaster Tools is a tool you need to set up early, because it's the place where people will inform you of any problems with your website. Is there anything wrong? Google will inform you right up about it, so you have time to react, to fix it fast, and to avoid any unpleasant consequences about it. While working with Google Webmaster Tools, you need to mind that it tracks HTTP and HTTPS as separate websites. So if you plan to move your entire website to HTTPS, you should set up the second account for HTTPS beforehand, so that you have the tracking unbroken. Google Analytics, a very powerful tool. It has several peculiarities you need to keep in mind, because if you don't, the data can be quite broken and bring you more harm than good. First thing is, when you're using several domains like we do at Xcard, for example, when we have blog on one subdomain and the forums on another subdomain, etc., we have quite a few of those, you need to set up tracking of all these domains under one same Google Analytics ID. Why do that? Because if you do not, when, say, on your homepage, someone clicks to go on your blog or forums or something else, if it's tracked under different IDs, you will see it as bouncer, as people who simply left your page. You will not know anything about what they did afterwards. If you track this all on the same ID, then you will see that these people went to forums, these people went to blog, etc. And you will see correct numbers about the bounce rate on your pages. Another matter to keep in mind is the filters. Filters in Google Analytics are very powerful, yet they do not filter any one data set. They filter in the raw clicks that come to you, Google Analytics account. And based on those clicks, they compile the data they demonstrate you. So if your filters filter out some clicks that you need to see, they are lost forever. So you need to be very sure when you're applying filters to your working to your main Google Analytics account. Safe way to handle this is to use several accounts. Say one account with raw data, one view in Google Analytics. One view with raw data, with no filters applied. The second view is your working view with filters applied that you sure that work, tested filters. And the third view is the view where you test new filters to see whether they destroy anything you need. And the final thing about it is to link your Google Analytics account with your Webmaster Tools, so that Google Analytics collects that little data about the traffic by the key phrases Google still discloses. Because in Webmaster Tools, you can see this data for 1-2 months. In Google Analytics, it can be kept indefinitely. Next, there is a technical side of your website that Google pays much attention to. And for most store owners, it's rather a challenge. Few store owners have the experience with this side of things. Webmasters usually care about the outer side of things, that website shows okay in browser, that everything looks fine. On the inner side, however, the HTML markup might be very broken, And I've encountered this several times in my practice that a website delivered content not with HTTP 200 code, but with HTTP 404. In this case, Google will think that the website consists solely of broken pages, non-existent pages, and won't give any credit at all, won't index anything. So it's things that you will need to look out. For highly competitive terms, I don't really see a way to handle it without a technical expert you can trust, someone reliable in-house or other ways who will not be gone, I want to not, and we will check these things for you. Still, there are things you can check yourselves even without any expertise with an instruction. So first thing to check is your DNS record. That's rather easy. Just type in Google check DNS, it will give you a number of free tools where you can just type in your domain name and see if anything is wrong with your DNS record. If anything is, you simply hand it over to your hosting company and then sort it out for you. Next thing, HTML consistency. This can be checked pretty easily with Worldwide Web Consortium Validator, W3C Validator. Generally, Google does not pay much attention if you have few errors on the page. Apart, if there are pages, but if there are pages, if there are errors, say in title or in title or meta description, things that Google usually puts to the snippets. So what you need to see is the amount of the errors on your pages compared to amount of errors on pages of your competition in Google search on the terms to which you aim to apply. If say you have 200 errors a page and your competition has 20, you'd be at great disadvantage. So it's best to minimize minimize the errors there. Yet eradicating them all might not be really necessary. Another thing you can check yourself is your web server setup. For this, I'm gonna share my screen a bit. Okay, here goes. Okay, in Google Chrome, you have this very nice tool, which you call with F12 button. Here you come. I will check this on the network tab. Click preserve log. And let's put xcard.com. It consists of a lot of comments, of course. So here we scroll to the top and see what's going on. Here is my request. Start with blue. X.com and .http 301. It's called permanent redirect. And redirects to X.com with 3W. It's a normal fine way. Back in the day, it was used to avoid duplicate content for Google. Then we did it separately, website with 3W and without 3W. Now we'll mostly learn to figure this out on its own, and also this can be handled with canonical instruction. Still, as you see, we're using it for its simple and reliable. And then, as redirection works out, here we have HTTP 200, so it's okay. You want to have 200 on every of your page, except special cases like this, 301 redirect I'm showing you. So if you check your main pages with this and see that if there's anything about 200, you should talk to your webmaster and see what's wrong. This can really upset Google about your website. Now, coming back to the presentation. Next thing you'd want to check is your IP. IP address can be reassigned, as I'm sure you all know. Thing about it is you can get an IP associated with spam or hackers. So you'd want to check your IP in the blacklist, whether it has anything to it, and if it does, talk to your hosting company about changing it. Finally, the website speed. It can be checked in Google Analytics, behavior, site speed, page timings report. It's pretty straightforward. You just check the numbers right to the page. And what you'd like is to have the page load time 5 seconds or below. Content. Google loves original content, and in my experience, it rewards the content wrote in playful style, when it's appropriate, of course, well more than official plain style. Why? I think because Google thinks that automatically generated content is one of the largest crimes there can be. So it dislikes anything that even remotely can look like an automatically generated content. Although there can be found some cases when Google actually can be manipulated to accept the automatically generated content and give credit for it. These cases are fewer and can be eliminated completely, more or less, with every next update. Yeah, natural speech patterns would be a good description. Although natural is not always original, so try to be eye-catching with your texts. Next thing, many store owners make call for a pretty design and remove any informative text from their homepage. In my experience, it's a mistake. Because Google puts very much emphasis on the text on the homepage, and especially text in text header text, like H1, H2, etc. And that's where you want to put the key phrases which you'd like to climb. Top key phrases must be your header text, in your title tag, in your meta description tag. That's what Google looks at most, and the informative text. It does not need to be long. That's about 200 words most, more than that. Next thing, most stores also get good traffic on the pages of actual products, because people search for actual products often by name, and you want to rank there well. It would not be so much traffic as for major keywords, yet it's traffic that converts very well. And you need to attract it. You need to tell Google that you're offering good content on those less popular but very useful terms. And for this, you need to write good text for every of your products. Well, I've seen quite a few stores that just copy and paste this text, like titles, meta descriptions, even product descriptions, or leave them empty. That's what you need to avoid, because when you do it, Google see all the amount of your product pages as kind of spammy content. Often it excludes it from search altogether. And while Google does so, it also devalues your efforts on your homepage and more prominent pages. It devalues all your website as spam. So don't cut the corners and try to write good content for all your pages, including every single product page. And while doing so, while writing all the text, you need to avoid over-optimization. What is it? It's mentioning keywords in your text too often. Now, for Google, 2-3 mentions a page is enough. 5 mentions is not too much, but it's max what you want to afford. If you make 10 mentions, one page, or one key phrase, that's not good. That's you risky. Google may again think that you're spamming them. And if Google think you're spamming them, they will ban you from the top, will not let you get there. And another thing about the markup, it's more a thing to your designer, to your webmaster. When updating your design, when building a new design for your store, keep in mind that Google loves when the text is close to the head of the page. The closer text to the head of the page, the more emphasis Google puts on it. So it's a good idea to move JavaScript and things like it to the bottom of the page or to outside files. Another quite important thing is the duplicate content. Nowadays, duplicate content is not as bad as it used to be. Google does penalize for it, yet much less than it used to, say, 5 years ago. Still, it's a thing you need to look into, a thing you need to monitor, because too much of it, Google will penalize you still. First, how you find it? There are, when you have a suspicion about having indicate content on some kind of page, for example, a product page, especially, or category pages, especially if you have modifications like filters, you take a unique text you think unique to the page, which you suspect to have duplicate pages, and type it in Google. Tap it in Google, adding instruction site column and your domain name. And then, if you have more than one result, it is very likely you have duplicate content. You should vote for the results and see whether it's the case. So once you find it, what do you do with it? The best solution is to kill it. It's to physically remove all pages that contain duplicate content. However, it's not often possible. It's often not possible technically. Other solution would be to close it with robots.txt. It's an easy solution. Almost cases works fast. There is, however, one drawback. Google is not taking robots.txt instructions as something obligatory. They take it as recommendations. So often the pages that blocked their robust XT are still in the index for months. And Google sees them, Google still considers them in their algorithm. So it's an easy solution, yet it should not be easily used. It should be used when other options are either too costly or not available. Also, you can manage duplicate content with canonical instruction. The weak point of canonical instruction is when you have an overly complicated site structure, you have a lot of pages which you must manage with this canonical instruction. It is an often occurrence that when you put one change or another, this canonical instruction gets broken in some way. So you will still have duplicate content, yet this presence of the canonical instruction would make it less prominent to you, but not less prominent to Google. So with canonical, you should be using it when you are sure what you're doing. Otherwise, it's best to use some other option. And the option we've used a few times is to move troublesome content to a subdomain. For example, when with the forums, we have a lot of older posts which get broken with broken links and this kind of thing, a lot of outgoing links, and we do not have pre-moderation in forums. Moving it to the subdomain is a good idea. Another thing you need to monitor about the content is links. Check for broken links regularly and fix them. The first way to find them would be the Webmaster Tools. It updates the reports on the broken links you have on your website regularly as Googlebot crawls it. Another place you can check it is Zeno's loop. Let me type it in the chat. It's a simple Windows application. It's pretty straightforward. The only limitation it has, it can crawl larger websites, so you will have to crawl it in portions if you have a large one. It's another way you can find the broken links in addition to Webmaster Tools. Google is not crawling your website entirely. It crawls some part of it, and the rest can be covered by Zen. Another thing, carefully choose the websites to which you link. Because when you link to a website, Google thinks you are related to them. And you don't want to be related, associated with a website Google thinks spammy or otherwise not trustworthy. An easy way to check it is to add an extension to your web browser which would take PageRank from Google. And if a website you plan to link has no PageRank records, like it's a gray bar, don't link to it. Very likely it has some sanctions from Google. And about outbound links, you should not put any outbound links on your homepage at all. Why? Because if you put an outbound link on the homepage, Google would think that you are affiliated with the website to which you link, and that the website to which you link is more important than Google. since you link me from your homepage. So it will give some credit, a lot of credit that your website has to that website, and will give no benefit to you, and even then hold you a bit from ranking high. And like with the forums, as I mentioned before, areas where you have a lot of outbound links, you should move it to a subdomain. Because, so you link first to a subdomain, and then subdomain links to the outer website. Google will know that the subdomain is still, yet it has less authority than your major website. That way you have the fine customer experience, which can still have the links they want, and Google will not give too much authority from your website to the website to which you link. Another thing is a technique I'm using. It's quite boring, yet I find it quite useful. It's a manual index check. But basically, you start typing Google site, column, your domain. And it gives you the complete list of the pages that Google got indexed in their base. Usually, you will need to narrow down the searches because the websites are usually more than 500 to 800 pages that Google usually shows in the search results. So let us see them all. And also, you would want to add get parameter, which is ampersand filter equals zero to the end of the URL Google search is giving you. This will force Google to show you the bad links, the bad pages, which Google thinks are spammy, or has any broken content, duplicate content, this kind of thing. And that's the kind of pages you'd like to see most. So then you just check the results, the snippets, page by page, and check search for broken or duplicate content. Very good to quite boring method to spot any abnormalities with your website and fix them. And for some pages, you want to check Google Cache, the way Google actually sees the content on the website. For this, you tap in Google Search Cache and the URL of your of the page you'd like to see. It's a good way to spot whether anything is broken with particular pages. It's you should check your major pages this way most of all to check whether anything broken in markup, whether all the components are indexing properly, whether nothing is blocked by robot stakes, this kind of thing. Other things Stijn mentioned already is behavioral factors. Google monitors the way the customers behave on the pages. The most important thing is the bounce rate. So when Google is sending traffic your way, customers opens your website and then just leaves, Google believes that they did not find what they were looking for. So your website is not worthy of sending traffic your way. And vice versa, if they stay on the page, if they click something there, and it means they found something there, and your website is good and it can get better rank. You can monitor this in Google Analytics in behavior section, site content, all pages report. So it's obvious that the smaller bounce rate you get, the better it is. And this is covered best. This was covered best by Stijn about SEO really work on. It must be an integral part of your entire marketing efforts. I can repeat you after Stijn that you need to produce interesting new content regularly, and the blog is a good way to do it. One thing I need to point out is you should not buy links under any circumstances, because Google gets more and more crafty about deciphering the bought links from organic ones. Sometimes get overzealous and analyzes for organic links. Not paid ones. So it's a thing you should never do. Do not buy links. And another tip from our experience would be to start an affiliate program when you solicit people to advertise your website or some of your products with links, with articles on their website and their resources. In particular, most modern engines that handle the affiliate marketing, including those built for our software for Xcard, can handle plain links without affiliate parameters, without affiliate gate parameters in it. So this way, and this kind of plain links is the kind of links you'd like to promote. These links, when they grow in mass, they will bring weight to your website naturally, while bringing more sales to you via the affiliate program. And that would be it. Questions and answers.
Thank you, Mike, for your presentation. We have collected all the questions into the single file together with Olga. And now I'm going to send the questions into the chat window one by one in that very order in which they arrived. And Stijn and Mike, please just select the appropriate question. And if it is yours, proceed with the answer. I guess that most of these questions are Xcard related, are rather technical. So I guess it will be Mike mainly who will be speaking. But Stijn, if you have something to add, please do that. And the very first question is in the chat window. How do you feel about the structure regarding coding W3C? How much of an impact does it have? Actually, this question has already been answered, I guess, in one of Mike's slides. But Mike, I guess you just need to repeat that and probably focus some more attention on this very part of search engine optimization.
Sure. W3C, following W3C standards to the letter, is a nice thing to have, yet it's not always necessary. When you aim to get higher in Google, what you need really is to be better than your competition. If you're much better than your competition there, then better advantage you have.
Thus, the conclusion is try to minimize the number of errors, because you will never be able to fix them all, right?
Yes, well, not always not able to fix them all. Well, for example, default templates for Xcard does not have any issues with W3C. It comes out clean. So it's technically possible to have it all rooted out, yet it's not always necessary.
Okay, I see. Thank you. And the next question is about mobile search engine optimization. What is the best practice for mobile SEO for e-commerce items with complex options? I guess this is the question about products with variants or options when you, for example, can select color, size, etc. Please correct me if I'm wrong with the question interpretation. But this is how I understand that. And Mike, will you please try to help our attendees with this very question?
The mobile search in Google is still a developing area. It's it changes much over time, and we've seen a pretty serious change just back in April when Google started using the level optimization for mobile as a factor to your position. As a factor to position the results in Google. As for products with complex options, well, it depends on actual kind of products. For example, color much matters very much if you're selling clothing, and matters quite less in some other areas. So what's the best approach here? The best approach here is to make an investigation on what your customers, on what your potential customers are actually looking for. For example, from one of the projects I had, there is a common searches when selling clothes, like blue dress or red dress. People actually searching for color thing without any additional options. So it would be best to create a product which exactly names, which has the preset option for this
Mike,
kind of searches.
Sorry to interrupt you. Douglas has just sent a link to the product he's speaking about. It's quite an original device for me, because I have never seen something like that alive. But anyway, please take a look. It will help you to answer this question better. So the link is
okay.
Available in the chat window.
Okay, hold on a bit. I'll take a look. Uh-huh. So it would be physical. Well,
so many options.
I cannot really tell you right now whether it would be best to split it in different products and some of these are this way, because I don't know the structure of traffic, the structure of search for your particular niche. This takes an investigation, research of the searching. Of the searching habits of your particular audience. It depends on what they actually search, what they actually would like to find.
So I guess we just need to move this question outside of the webinar, and you Mike will take a look and probably send a short conclusion to Douglas after having a thought on this very difficult and deep question. Do you mind?
Well, I can do it. But I'm not promising I will do it very fast.
Okay, just I'm reading a note to remind
forget,
you.
Yes,
that.
Don't forget to leave your email address.
I have an email address. And the next question is also related to search engine optimization and mobile devices, but I cannot send it for some reason. Just a second. The link is outside of my screen. Quite an awkward situation. Oh, this is it. So the question is about responsive web design versus a separate model scheme. So what are the pros and cons of using RWD, responsive web design, over having a separate model site or scheme from a sales standpoint?
Well, there is no really a clear difference whether you use two separate schemes or regular user users and mobile ones, or whether you use adaptive scheme. It's not actually the technology, it's the way you handle it. Either might work, and either might work badly. It mostly depends on the quality of markup and quality of content. In my experience, what matters is more is not the way Google accepts it, it's the way your users accept it, the way your users like it. And it really depends not on the technology, whether it's a separate template or it's a one adaptive template. It depends on how it made, to suit your audience.
Olga, will you please send the next question because I have a technical issue here. So, is there any word count before the content is considered duplicated? In other words, what you say duplicate content. For example, if we take one sentence, a group of words, or a catchphrase, when should I be concerned to determine that the content is considered duplicated? Quite an interesting question for me too, because I work with the site text. So, Mike, please shed some light on that.
Oh, Google. To determine this kind of thing, uses thing called fuzzy logic. So, kind of algorithms from the artificial intelligence kind of algorithms. What it means is Google considers everything duplicate content to some extent. Just some things it's a very little extent, for others it's very large. So what you need is to keep this duplicate content measure of Google's as minimal as possible. Currently, if you change about 20% of the text, Google will not flag it as completely duplicate. However, Google will know that it's not completely unique, and it will not value it highly. So, if there is a content that you'd like to be valued highly, that you'd like Google to give higher ranking, it must be as unique as it's technically possible.
Thank you, Mike. Actually, this is what we were doing, publishing 29 translation modules for XCard 5. Yes, we have 29 new translations for XCard 5. And now is the next question from Olga. Will you please send it? Many of you are asking whether how they can reach the slides and the webinar recording. We are recording this webinar session right now. We will need to trim it probably, and after that I will first of all publish it in our blog, in that very article where the invitation to the webinar was published. I will also upload the video to our YouTube channel. XCard team has such a channel. And I will also email both the link to the recording and the slides from Mike's presentation to you by email. And if Stijn shares his slides, I will also include them too. So please rest assured we are going to deliver this content into your mailboxes too. And the next question is also very interesting for me. It's about products which are not generally welcomed at eBay, PayPal, and etc. So to quote the question itself, I find that eBay, PayPal, Facebook, and others don't like products like such as knives, pepper spray, and gun accessories. Could search engines be deemed use because we have these products on our website? So how does such products affect the website ranking? Michael Stijn,
well,
do you have something?
Well, I can tell a bit about this topic. Well, Google does not really penalize websites based on the product they have. And what they do is they separate search for different kind of products. For example, in default Google search, you will not see certain areas, you will not see certain products advertising, like tobacco, like gambling, like firearms, this kind of thing. So some items that's on the border of these things, like gun accessories, they will not really have trouble competing against other stores offering this kind of merchandise on Google. They, however, will have limited access to Google audience, because Google limits their audience based on these things. Google generally limits audience based on all the well, search preferences, the search history, location of visitors. Yet with this kind of products, this kind of limitation is more prominent in my experience.
Okay, thank you so much for your answer. Olga, will you please send the next question? I think one of the hottest questions was about placing one product into different categories, into several categories. But Olga sent another question first. So what is the best way to structure your product hierarchy if you have products directly under a category as opposed to being set in subcategories? Is that more beneficial? So how deep you can place your products not to worsen your website ranking, I guess?
It really depends on many, many factors, how you best organize this kind of thing. Generally, Google puts less weight to the pages that are deeper within website structure. However, even if you use this deeper hierarchy in the categories, you can use tricks like sitemap to still have them not deep in your site, in your website hierarchy. So it really depends on how exactly you do it, what is your niche, and what is your audience. Search habits. Mm-hmm. There is no one answer to this question.
So a deeper look into the very site itself is required to answer more exactly, right? Yes. The next question, which is hot for several customers of ours, is about a single product in multiple categories, whether it will be considered as duplicate content and affect the ranking or not, because Xcard allows to select several categories for a single product. How does that work, and how should that work?
Generally, in Xcard, default behavior, product has one URL regardless of from which category you come to see. So it's not a duplicate content. It's one and the same product in all categories, just different ways a customer can come to it. And for Google, it's perfectly fine.
So you can place the product into as many categories as you would like to, providing the navigation is convenient for your customers. The URL is still unified, so everything will be okay, right?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. And the next question is about Pinterest broken links, because Pinterest is now using HTTPS, which is getting quite fashionable, taking into account that, for example, Firefox announced that they are deprecating HTTP support. So the question is, how do you fix the Pinterest broken links? I think it's quite a technical question. But anyway, if you can answer it, please do that, Mike.
Well, I cannot give an exact instruction from the top of my head. Yet I believe you need to change one letter in the template that handles this. I trust our technical support can help you with this.
Thank you. Olga, please post one more question. It was about two stores of older versions, about 4.4.3 and 3.5.4, about HTML catalog function. While I will read this question aloud, please post that into the chat window to make it clearer for our guests to see the question itself. So what are the best steps to optimize the store of version 4.4.3 and the store of version 3.5.4 with HTML catalog function? For example, on the first store, 4.4.3, is it best to use HTML catalog or use Apache CleanRel? And for another store, 3.5.4, is it best to use HTML or PHP pages, since things have changed so much? So the question is in the chat window. Please read it, because it's quite difficult to comprehend that orally, I mean, the sound version. Just take a look.
Well, generally, I can tell that currently, it is more convenient and more resultative is to use the PHP pages with what we write, with clean URLs, as it is called in later XCAP versions. For what you might wish to use the HTML catalog is to improve speed. For example, if you have a very large website, say with a million products, and you'd like it to work faster, you want to use HTML catalog. That in case if your inventory is not updated too often, because if it is, then regenerating the HTML catalog would really have all the benefits you'll be getting from it. As for the best ways to optimize, it again depends very much on the kind of store you have, the products are you selling, their number, their consistency, search habits for your targeted audience. So far, I have not seen two stores for which I'd recommend same ways of improving their relations with Google.
Mike, will you please try to speak a bit louder, then you will be answering the next question while Douglas is collecting the lead in our chat window. it was about adding, just a second, about adding an existing Google Analytics tracking code. Olga, will you please post the question here? It was about, I will just read it aloud right now. I have a client who added me as an admin to their Google Analytics account. There is already an UA tracking code created under their account. I'm using that tracking code in the Google Analytics module in XCard. However, when I link the domain to Google Webmaster Tools, as you, Mike, recommended in your presentation earlier, it generates a different tracking code, which I cannot add to the XCard module. So what is the best way to handle this? So actually,
Give me a few moments to sync it in.
Sure. And this is, by the way, the last question that we have received. If we missed something, please send your question into the chat window too, because we tried to collect all the questions and restructure them to make more easier to understand. But if we missed something, please post your questions here and now. Also, I would like to remind about the first presentation Stijn prepared us. It was more focused on marketing side of search engine optimization. So if you have questions to Stijn, you're welcome to ask, because Stijn is still here. And I think this is an excellent opportunity to talk to such a great expert. What is the best way to determine the customer search habits on our website? This is what Charles is asking. Probably.
Okay, about the question.
Which
about
one?
The question. So about linking Google Analytics with Webmaster Tools. Yes, there is an issue like this. Generally, to link Google Analytics and Webmaster Tools, you need to have one, say, Google account with admin access to both the Webmaster Tools and Analytics, and then it will verify the same Google account with admin access to both the Webmaster Tools and Google Analytics. In other way, in a lot of cases, it won't verify and give you an error with no plain description what to do.
Mike, are you trying to share the screen?
Hi, Xenia. I see the question, what's the best way to determine customer search habits on your website? Mm-hmm. What I think is very important to start with is to understand where people from when they land on your website. Yeah, I was trying to share the screen, Xenia, but somehow I cannot. I think we need to close the presentation first.
No, you do not need to close the presentation. Just click on the plus symbol, which is the next tab. And it will allow you to share the screen.
Yeah, it has, my share your screen is grayed out. I can only do open presentation, show whiteboard, open YouTube video. So I'm not sure. But yeah, what I would do, Charles, I would go to something like SEMrush or Moz. It doesn't really matter what tool you use. And look at where people are coming from when they land on your website. What were they searching for? And the best, easiest way to do it is to look at how your pages are ranking. Because Google does not give you a lot of detail anymore on organic search terms. What I do, I try to see, okay, what pages are ranking for what keywords? And how much traffic are they driving to the website? So you can relatively quickly see how much percentage of your website traffic comes from people searching for what? How much comes from people who are searching for branded keywords, for example, that know you already, versus how many people are searching for something that's not related to your brand, and that's relatively new content. And then, of course, you want to make sure they land on great landing pages, etc. But that's what I think is the starting point to understand search habits. I'm not sure if that's your question or more about navigation once they are on your website. But the search habits itself, although Google limits a lot of the insights that you can get there, I think by reviewing the keyword rankings for landing pages, you can still get a lot of insights.
Thank you, Stijn.
Yeah, but Doug is typing here, look at funnels in Google Analytics. Once people are on your website, then of course there are many other tools, from Webmaster Tools to Google Analytics to things like Crazy Ag, where you can basically see how people behave. How they go from one page to the next, things like conversions on Google Analytics funnel views, where people leave when they bounce off a page, where do they go to. So there's a lot of depth once you actually have them on your website.
Yes, I also love Crazy X. It gives quite interesting statistics. It shows heat maps and clicks, so it shows how the customers are clicking on different pages of your website. And also, I'd like to say about Yandex Metrics. It's an interesting tool, like to Google Analytics, but developed by research engine Yandex. They allow to record the sessions of your customers and watch them later, you know? So you can actually see how a particular visitor was browsing your website and see all his mouse movements and etc. It's very interesting. Just take a look. This is what I was speaking about.
Like Crazy Ag is one more thing on Crazy Ag. What's really cool, Xenia's comment, if you use a tool like Crazy Ag, it's a little more detailed than Google Analytics. you can see not just where people click on your website, but also where they were coming from before they clicked and before they came on your website. So you can see who clicks on what part of your website, but also where that person came from, what they were searching for, what device they were coming from, all the typical details that you get in Google Analytics on where traffic comes from, but then sort of aligned with what their behavior, how they click, where they are going in your website, etc.
No, Douglas, Crazy Egg is not very expensive. I cannot tell for sure.
No, it's like $20, I think.
This is very affordable, yes.
It's really cheap.
And what I love about that is that the reports are pretty colorful and it's very interesting to monitor the results. And also it allows you to track visitors separately depending on their device. I mean, you can have a separate click map for desktop and a separate one for mobile devices and a separate one for tablets. And it's really very and very easy to integrate it. You are just getting a JavaScript code, which you need to place above the body tag on your pages. So it's extremely easy and quickly, and you are ready to collect, to see the results, depending on your traffic, probably even the same day. Yes. Thank you for sharing the link. So Mike was going to share his desktop, I guess. And Mike, are you still with us?
Yes, I'm here. What exactly for? No, it was Stijn trying to share his.
Oh, he has already thought of that better and did not find a quick way, so decided not to share the screen. So, Mike, if you are ready to answer the question about generating and not allowing to use another tracking code, please share some light on that for us.
Well, I already have. The trick to it is to have one same Google account with admin access to both Webmaster Tools and Google Analytics. It must be the same Google account, and then it will validate. Otherwise, it will give incomprehensive error.
Well, I'm looking through the chat window and I'm not sure if I can find any other question. I think we're almost all set. If any questions are still left, please post them now. Will XCard ever have a dynamic rendering for portable devices capability? Thank you for that question. Will you please clarify what's the difference between this very thing and the responsive design which XCard has out of the box? Thank you, Sean. So I'm not sure about a dynamic rendering, so I cannot answer for sure this very question right now, but I can try to find it out later and send the question by email in any way. You can just post this into the ideas portal of ours, and in this case it will be queued for implementation once it collects the number of pulls, so that we could understand that the feature is in demand indeed. I'm sorry for not being able to answer this question right now. So the last question was about offering courses in the US. I guess you're speaking about educational courses, right? Well, we have a large number of resellers and friends such as Mike White, for example, from Baby Monkey Studios. I guess almost everyone knows him. Or Steve Stayano from CFL System, Kerry Saunders from CS Engineering. So these are the US-based companies which do offer consulting. So you are welcome to get in touch with them. And they are very easy to reach. While we are located on the other side of the globe, we are offering also different kinds of services, because as you understand, such very courses are not easy to make universal for, useful for every attendee. And the questions like search engine optimization actually requires a very targeted approach with analysis of your personal website, with studying its peculiarities, and thus it's way better to just have a personal, for example, training and personal research investigation. And Mike Bazhutin, our second presenter, does offer such a service, so you're welcome to ask him about for help, or at least you do not need to purchase the service of optimization itself. You may also get some kind of consultation. So Mike is some kind of universal solder. He can either tell you what to do with your website, or he can help you to do that, so depending on your vision skills. And as I also remember, on our website there is a big red sale person. It's Tracy Corner, who is offering search engine optimization too. And they are very interesting. They just offer a single website in that very niche. For example, if you are a plumber, they are promising that they will do their best to make you number one plumber among the plumber websites. And they will not take another customer who is also a plumber, just because they cannot make two customers in the same niche, number one, which is their main purpose. So I love this approach, and you can also consider contacting our specialists or our partners. We have lots of. I think it must be way better from the point of view of effectiveness of that service for you. Oh, I can see several more questions. The question is about a dedicated page that offers SEO resource links to various websites that provide scan tools, articles, or other helpful information. Mahashwar, I'm sorry if I'm pronouncing your name incorrectly. We do have several publications in our blog. They were prepared by our partners from Position Lee. Olga, will you please post them into the chat window? I think that Positionally a very good Poland-based search engine optimization company. So they prepared, I guess, three articles with quite a number of links you might consider good and useful and interesting. They cover both on-site and off-site SEO. Yes, thank you so much, Olga. This is the first link. There will be two more. What the SEO W3C optimizations does Xcard offer for current licensed cards? Charles, first of all, it's search engine optimization service, which Mike will be speaking about. As for W3C, our design department can help you to clear your templates from errors, so this service is also available. You may request a quote. The quotation itself is free. Just drop us a line to sales@x-card.com. or contact us via your help desk account, and you will get a quote for both types of tasks. But as for sales service, Mike, will you please tell you what can you offer? Mike?
Well, the sales service, I was putting on my mic. Well, the sales service I'm doing, it consists of several parts. First, I'm doing the audit, to root out the technical issues and major content problems, if there are any, with the website. And then we discuss with the particular website owner the further options of what we do. I can do the sales strategy for them. Also, I can simply keep an eye that they do not lose their ranking, although if they already have achieved some results. Well, it's best discussed regarding particular projects. They're discussed more to the ground. this is it's few things I can tell generally. So if you're interested in this kind of service, feel free to post a mail to me. I'll look into your budget and we'll let you know about the options we have.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you for your questions. As for the upcoming webinars, we will also be posting the announcements in our blog. If you are interested in further information from Stijn and Mike, please do drop me a line. I'm especially interested in those questions which you would like to have covered, because it will help us to provide you with the information you are interested in. And if you would like some more information from the team which was working for you today, we're happy to do that. Just let us know. So it looks like we're all set for today. Scott White is typing. I'm waiting for Scott's message. So this is the very last chance for you guys to send your questions. By the way, Mike, I have just realized that we haven't answered the question about the same tracking code. Have you found out that information, or should we just mark this question as a non-answered one and follow up our guest by email with answer?
Xenia, I have already answered to this question twice. You want me to repeat it three times?
I'm sorry I missed that.
Okay.
So thank you everyone for coming. Thank you for your time. Thank you, Stijn, for your excellent and interesting presentation. Thank you, Michael, for your technical side. And thanks.
Thanks for having us.
I also found out a lot of interesting info today. Have a good day. Goodbye.
Thanks, everyone.